I'm very happy to be here with you today, where we are discussing a very important matter as Minister of Lands to anchor the rights of women in respect to land, in respect to access to opportunities, in respect to anchoring ownership rights in registration of titles. In a country like Uganda, when you want to deal with the question of empowerment of women, you have to look at the over 70% of the women who derive their sustainability, livelihood from agriculture and informal business opportunities. The leadership percentage of women, the class of my class, the educated elite class, who benefit from women's leadership position are very few. So we need to look at policies, programs, and empowerment that deals directly with the over 70% of women who derive their livelihood from the unemployed formal sector. Therefore, I want to tackle the issues of laws, policies, and programs, and judicial and administrative mechanisms put in place to address some of these aspects of women's empowerment. I want to start with women in agriculture. And I think majority of the women here today are majorly women who derive their livelihood from farming. Majority of the women in Uganda derive their livelihood from agriculture. Statistics indicate that over 70% of the women in Uganda are agricultural farmers. Most of them organize as women's farmers groups or within the farmers groups broadly. They provide both informal and formal employment in agriculture. With that, I think the most important aspect is Minister of Agriculture has put in place mechanism within which women can access seedlings, seeds, but the structure for the distribution of these seeds and seedlings, when they reach the district level, the men decide to usurp the process of distribution, and in most circumstances, most women do not get it. So as women's organization, as women in government, we have formed ourselves in cabinet to see to it that distribution of seeds and seedlings to women-headed household, to women farmers groups are focused on, but most especially registering women's farmers groups so that the target for distribution of agricultural seeds and seedlings implements should focus on women's farmers groups and women's households. That is very important to us, because if we have to handle the issue of productivity of agriculture, it is important. And I want also to handle the issue of land ownership and access to land as a broad question. In most circumstances, majority of the women do not have ownership of land. In customary system, which is over 70% of land ownership in Uganda, is customarily owned. From the east to the north to part of the west, it is customary. Milo is majorly only in this region of Buganda and parts of the former Kibale, Greater Kibale. Now, women do not own land, but they only have access to land. And access to land is on the basis of marriage. In most circumstances, in customary ownership, if you are not married, it is difficult for you to access land. Yes. And women whose marriages breaks down and they go back to their homes, access to land is based on sympathy from brothers, from uncles, and from fathers. And it makes it very difficult. So we need to handle the issue of ownership. And in the systematic registration, in the policy that now in the Ministry of Land we are developing. But as an empowerment question, the issue of access to land, because the law now only provides protection on matrimonial land and matrimonial property, but the broader access to land, ownership of land to women is wanting. So we need to address clearly the question of ownership, because only access brings barriers to women in respect to what the chairperson from the farmers group from Oyam stated, that yes, when you access land, somebody else own it, you produce and after production, then the person who has overall ownership of the land will come and say, okay, this is the produce, now I'm going to sell 5 bags, I'm going to sell this, and for you now, you sit down, your own voice on the actual produce. Should we sell? Should we have food security? For most women, becomes a fallacy. So we must now address both the question of access and ownership to land if we have to empower women. The other issue I want to address is the issue of women in informal businesses, because both the women in agricultural sector becomes informal business people. Either they are going to sell tomatoes, or they are going to sell onions or cabbages and others. But there are also other women who will engage in other informal businesses. And the most important question for empowerment is the question of access to credit and financial collateral. In Uganda, over 80% of collateral, actually 86% of collateral, is by way of either land or property. If you walk to the bank and you want to borrow a loan to start a business, informal or not, they will ask you for a collateral. What is that collateral? Either it's a land title or a title for a house. And how many women are able to give this collateral? Statistics shows that only 7% of women own land. 7% own land. So if only 7% own land, it goes to the backbone of how do you access capital to start a business. Because empowerment, when we talk about driving into the middle income economy, we have to look at how many can start their own business. How many can access credit? Because you cannot develop from nowhere. Most of you requires capital. So the issue of majority of women accessing credit is very important. And yet, research has shown from Private Sector Foundation that over 40% of registered businesses are owned by women. You struggle very hard and you own this informal business. When you go into this informal business, you'll find saloon, you'll find restaurants, you'll find this. Even in villages, you find a very small written hotel, and they are making food for you, even when you go to the villages. They are selling all these small, small things. But in that, with the 40% who are registered business owners, with either registration from a town council, from a sub-county, or from a district, only out of the 40%, only 9% are able to access credit. So therefore, empowerment, we need to look at how do we facilitate women to access credit, which is very important. Of course, tied to all this is lack of information. There are some important programs being run by government, but also the problem is information. You know what I've realized? Information are always accessed during either when men are drinking in bars, or either they are, yes, in social gatherings. Now, imagine Private Sector Foundation for the last 7 years has been running a program funded by DFID and other donor partners for women's business owned to give them grants to start business. But how many women-based organizations, farmers groups, and so on, have this information? Most of you do not have the information. And yet there is that program seated there. You have, this program gives a grant, some of them, even now if you go to the webpage of Private Sector Foundation, you will find on a, in areas of agriculture, affirmative action for women-owned businesses. But why, even if you have information, why would it be difficult? Because the business, the structure of doing business is very difficult for women. For you to access that money from private sector, you need to have a registered company. The law related to registered companies or registration of business is so cumbersome. For a rural woman down there to start looking for lawyers, to draft article of association of the company, to do all this, you know, it is very, very difficult. So while there are programs for government to facilitate women's based businesses and farmers group to help them to ensure that they are able to get some of these opportunities, we still need to look at what are the barriers that makes it difficult for access. So recently we have identified these barriers, and we are working with the Uganda Registration Bureau to see how to reform this kind of I don't want to call it draconian, but very, very elaborate way of registration of business and access to credit and access to grants from private sector and government, so that it is, it can enable the empowerment of women. Of course, there are women that have benefited, but they have benefited because they have been helped by non-governmental organizations to put their books together, to put their articles of association. In that circumstance, where organized groups like the V Agroforest, if they have information on such, they are able to facilitate and to help some of their groups. So I also want to appeal that for most of you, the non-governmental organization, it will be vital for you to be a bridge between the women's farmers groups so that you facilitate them, you help them to come up with some of this registration and so on, to be able to access some of this business venture. The other issue which I want to address, if we are to look at the position of women's empowerment, is the issue of access to social services. Because you cannot be empowered, you can't do what you want to do as a farmer if the basic social services is wanting. We need your health to be okay for you to be empowered to do other things. So as women, we need to balance. Empowerment ties hand in hand with education for the girl child, for example, so that when this generation that has been struggling is old, the next generation is more empowered than this generation. Because when she talks about women in leadership, you can't be a leader without having papers. So we must now work to ensure that empowerment begins from ensuring that the girl child is educated. Even us who are not educated as women, we must now work very hard to make sure that our daughters are not like us, that our daughters are educated, because most of these opportunities come when people are educated. So girl child education is the fundamental empowerment tool that women must embrace. The issue of ensuring that our health system works for women, if you look at the statistics of how many women die during birth, is reducing, is stagnant. We need to address that. How do we address it? That women who are struggling down there to make a living, when their health is in problem, they are able to go to a health center and they are able to be taken care of. That pregnant women will not die because they are giving life to a human being. Training and capacity building, especially for established women's groups, and also organizing women into groups, mobilizing women, organizing them, and building their capacity and training them is very important. Because as non-governmental organization, it is important that you bring women in groups like this, because most of the government intervention are directed at organized groups. Most of the benefit that comes out of organized groups are well documented. So it's important that when we organize women, then passing information on availability and opportunities also becomes easy. And I want to deal lastly with the issue of women in leadership, which she has articulated very well. Women in leadership should not only be women in parliament by statistics. It should be women in parliament or in leadership with an agenda for women. So what is the agenda that the women should push? When I was in a chair of a WOPA, those are the issues that as women in parliament, we had to put forward in as far as number one, what are the laws that impedes women's empowerment? We put in place three vital laws that we did it as women in parliament. But now when the Ministry of Gender goes to international forum, those are the laws they report. But those laws were deliberately pushed by women in parliament as private members' bill. The Domestic Violence Act, the Trafficking in Persons Act, the Female Genital Mutilations Act, those were private members' bill pushed by women in parliament. And with this, I want to declare your workshop open.